بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatul Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. Proceeding. The subject إن شاء الله will be about the foundation of this religion and the first fundamental of Islam. That is the subject regarding Tawheed, and I will cover it inshallah by going through the book of Tawheed by the Honorable Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, one of the great scholars, contemporary great scholars, one of the great Salafi scholars of nowadays. The book is a very brief one actually, and it contains things regarding Tawheed systematically, point by point, which makes it much easier for someone to memorize and to understand. The Sheikh has divided his book into four sections. The first section is devoted to the deviations from Tawheed. And the second section is devoted to the detailed aspects of those deviations. And the third section is devoted to the rights of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and our obligations towards him, also as a subsequent subject with it, the rights of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions, and our duties and obligations toward them. And finally, the fourth subject, which is the innovations, regarding the innovations. I believe the Sheikh has done this kind of divisions in his book to point out to the two aspects of our testification to La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. The first part of this word, which is Ashhadu an La ilaha illallah, is dealt with in the first two sessions. And the second part of this testification is dealt with in the last two sections of the book. As Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah has said, Tawheed is two kinds. To unify the sender, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who sent the messengers and the books, and to unify the sended, or the sended ones. In our case, he is the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To unify Allah in his lordship and worship, and to unify the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in following and obedience. And this is the brief meaning of the testification to La ilaha illallah and Muhammadan Rasulullah. The author started his book by giving a general description of how the mankind or the creation, meaning the humans and the jinn, has deviated from Tawheed all through history. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in his book that I have not created the jinn and ins but to worship me alone and not to associate any partners with me in worship. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, meaning for none but to worship me. And this means but to unify me in worship. Because if someone worships Allah, but at the same time he does not unify him with worship, he rather associates partners in worship, then he has not worshipped him. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell the kafirs, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. O Muhammad, say to the kafirs that you are not worshipping whom I worship. Why would he tell them that they are not worshipping, even though they had worships? They used to fast, they used to make umrah, they used to make hajj, they used to make tawaf, they used to make salat. Even salat is mentioned in their poetry, plus many other forms of worship they had. But because they associated partners with Allah in worship, they were considered not to be worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been made very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it straight in his book that he has only created both jinn and mankind for the purpose of singling him out in worship and worshipping him alone and not associating partners with him in worship. But of course, the human is weak, and if he is left alone with his desires, this would eventually lead him to setting rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship in one way or another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to be straight on worshipping him, to be sincere in worshipping him. فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. Make your face or sit your face towards the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight, and do not bend towards shirk. Do not lean towards shirk. Hanifa, hanif means leaning away from shirk or turning away from shirk and turning straight to tawheed. This is the word hanif. Hanif means to turn away from shirk and to be straight on tawheed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. This is the instinct which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in us when he created us. And therefore, no one has the right to switch away or to turn away from this instinct that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for us. That is the instinct of Tawheed, the instinct of Islam, the instinct of worshipping him alone and not associating any partner with him in worship. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, every child is born on this instinct, but his parents turn him to Judaism or Christianity or other religions other than the truth. So the original religion, the truth is Islam, is Tawheed. And things which are away from the original or a deviation from the original, that is any other religion but Islam, whether it is Christianity, Judaism, or whatever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in his book that all mankind was on one religion. كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً. All humans were on one religion. And this was from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, our first father, until the time of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, the prophet Nuh. All those nations were Muslims. The first shirk which has occurred during the time where Nuh alayhi salam was sent to warn against. So Nuh was the first messenger who was sent to warn against the shirk which has occurred. And this has been explained by Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma. He said, between Adam and Nuh, peace be upon them, there were 10 centuries. All of them were on Islam. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said in his book Ighathatul Lahfan, volume 2, page 102, he said, what Ibn Abbas said is the clear-cut truth. And then he mentioned other verses which support the same meaning. So this is the general history of deviations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the mushriks that besides their faith in Allah, they associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. So the mushriks in general did not deny Allah's lordship, but they denied his worship. They did not deny the fact that Allah is the only Lord, the only creator, the only provider, the only sustainer, the only master, the only ruler. They did not deny this, but they denied the unity of Allah in worship. They thought that he is the greatest to be worshipped, but in order for them to worship him properly, they need partners or associates. They need mediators between them and Allah. They need intercessors between them and Allah. This was the situation for most of the nations since shirk has occurred at the time of Nuh alayhi salam until the time our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came with the same message as all prophets before him, that is to warn people against worshipping others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in his book, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اِعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ, that we have sent a messenger in every nation, ordering the people as their first order to unify Allah in worship, to worship Allah alone, and to stop worshipping the deities besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to avoid worshipping deities besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ, that most of them do believe in Allah and yet commit shirk. Ibn Abbas, the great companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, explained this, and he said, they believe in his lordship, that he is the Lord, the creator, the master, the provider, and they commit shirk, meaning set up rivals with Allah in his worship, that is, they worship others with him. Then the author starts with those deviations one by one. The first deviation that he starts with is the shirk. That is to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. The author says that shirk is to set up an equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his lordship or in his worship, or to set up a rival with Allah in his lordship or in his worship. Now, the shirk in lordship includes also the shirk in the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are part of his lordship. The Lord is the most perfect in his attributes. And the author says, what is most occurrent of the two types of shirk is the shirk in worship in all nations until now, until this day. Of course, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to this nation, the shirk was wiped out at a certain time. But then, after 4 or 5 centuries of the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, due to the ignorance and due to the plots of shaitan, shirk started to come back again to this nation. It started gradually. And this is not something strange, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned in many true hadiths that groups amongst this nation will go back to idol worshipping. And idol worshipping does not necessarily mean that one puts a stone and prostrates for him. Of course, this is idol worshipping. But idol worshipping could take many other forms, many other forms. To supplicate to other than Allah is idol worshipping. To accept other than the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is idol worshipping, and so on. Then the Shaykh says the shirk, which is the great shirk that takes someone out of Islam, is the greatest sin because of 5 or 6 points. First, because shirk is actually resembling the creature to the creator in what is special of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is special of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyone who associates a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he has resembled him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is the greatest injustice. To make someone equal to Allah, this is the greatest injustice, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Indeed, associating partners to Allah is the greatest injustice. And injustice is to put something in an improper place. And to put worship for other than Allah is indeed injustice. And it is indeed the greatest injustice. Also, the second point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said about shirk that he will never forgive someone who does not repent from it truly. So shirk is the kind of sin that if someone dies without repenting, he has no chance to be forgiven in the day of judgment. He will be in hellfire forever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah does not forgive to set up rivals with him in worship, but he forgives what is less than shirk, what is less than that. The third point, that Allah has made paradise unlawful for those who die on shirk. So anyone who dies on shirk, he will never go to paradise. He will stay in hellfire forever. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارِ. He who commits shirk, he who sets up rivals with Allah and worship, then Allah has made paradise unlawful for him, and he has made his destination and his household in the hereafter to be hellfire, to be hellfire. And no one can support the unjust on the Day of Judgment. The fourth point is that shirk, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cancels all the good actions that one does. No good action will be accepted or will be worth anything in the Day of Judgment for someone who sets up partners with Allah in worship. Aisha radiallahu anha, as narrated by Bukhari, says, O Messenger of Allah, Abdullah ibn Jad'an, one man who died as a mushrik, was in the time of pagan worshipping doing such and such and such good things. She mentioned few good things that he was doing. Would all that be benefiting him? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said no, because he never supplicated to Allah sincerely, because he was a mushrik. How could he supplicate to Allah sincerely? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, if they were to commit shirk, walau ashraku, lahabita anhum ma kanu ya'malun. If they were to commit shirk, that is anyone who commits shirk, then all that which they do of good deeds will be cancelled. It will be worthless. And also in the other verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. That it has been revealed to you and to the ones before you that if you were to commit shirk, associate partners with Allah in worship, then all your actions will be destroyed, cancelled, and you will be amongst the losers on the Day of Judgment. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the kafirs on the Day of Judgment that وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا, that we will turn all their actions into mirage, into dust. It will be worthless. So the kafir on the Day of Judgment will not benefit from any of his actions in this life. That means he will not benefit in a way where he might be saved from hellfire. He'll be in hellfire forever, despite the good actions that he has done in this life. These actions might benefit him in this life. Allah might reward him for them, but in the Day of Judgment, he will find nothing. The fifth point is that the mushrik's blood will not be sacred. Of course, this is a general ruling for mushriks and kafirs, but this does not mean that a Muslim is allowed to transgress against any kafir or any mushrik who might have an oath with Muslims because he has entered their country or something like that. Because unfortunately, many ignorants nowadays take only part of what they think to be the teachings of Islam and leave out the other parts. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in true hadith, he who kills a kafir who has an oath with Muslims, then he will not smell the smell of paradise. This shows that it is a great sin. And the sixth point is that shirk is the greatest of major sins. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shouldn't I inform you of the greatest of the major sins? They said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, to associate partners with Allah in worship. And then next to that, not to be obedient to to your parents. This is next to shirk. And therefore, shirk is the greatest of injustice. And tawheed is the greatest of justice. And the seventh point is that shirk is a way to slander Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to belittle him. Because what is more slanderous to the Creator than to resemble him with the creature, when the Creator is the all-powerful and the creature is weak? No matter how powerful he is still weak in some ways. Where the Creator is the Almighty and the creature's might is deficient. Where the Creator is the owner of everything, the creature doesn't even own his soul. It's all owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah created him. Allah created his soul. Allah decided for him to live. Allah decides for him to die. So how could someone be just when he gives the, or when he resembles the creature to the creator, or gives some of the rights of the creator which are special of him to the creature? This is the greatest injustice. Then the author goes into the types of shirk, and he says, in general, the types of shirk are two types. One is the greater shirk, which takes someone out of Islam and causes the person who dies on it to be in hellfire forever. And the definition of that shirk in general is to make any form of worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any form of worship, whether it is an inner worship, a worship of the heart, or an outer worship, that means worships of the tongue and the limbs. Worships of the heart, such as the worship of love, not the natural love, but the worship of love, the worship of fear, the worship of reverence and desire, the worship of trust and dependence. These actions of the heart are special of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you associate partners with Allah in any of those actions of the hearts, then you are worshipping that person with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also actions of the limbs, such as prayers, kneeling, prostration, sacrificing, and so on. These are forms of worship. To make any of those worships for other than Allah is a great shirk. The second form of shirk is the smaller shirk, which does not take someone out of Islam, but it definitely decreases the tawheed of someone. Even the sins decrease the tawheed and decrease the faith. Similarly, the small shirk decreases tawheed and decreases one's faith. Now, it is also divided into two. The smaller shirk is divided into two. One is the apparent small shirk, and the other is the vague small shirk or smaller shirk. The apparent also could be either by words or actions. So words like swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or some statements like saying, I trust Allah and you, I depend on Allah and you, or if Allah wills and you will. These words are smaller shirk, which are great sins. They are greater than the normal sins like fornication or whatever, because they are shirk. They are called shirk, even though they are not of the type which will take you out of Islam completely, but they are very dangerous, and they are called smaller shirk because they most probably will lead you to greater shirk. If you remain on them, they will lead you to greater shirk. And the actions which are apparent and which are considered to be smaller shirk, like wearing amulets, wires or springs, bracelets for the sake of protection. Anything that you put on for the sake of protection, which has no medical background, then this is a form of omnit, and this is a form of smaller shirk, even if it is a very tiny piece of glass, red or blue or whatever, that you might put in your pocket, or you might put here and there, whatever it might be. What the kafirs nowadays call good luck. They have a coin that they think this is good luck with them. All these are called omnits, and they are all small shirk. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned that anyone who wears such a thing is committing shirk. And we will come to them, inshallah, in detail. Then the second form of the smaller shirk is the hidden shirk, which is the smaller shirk which is in the heart, hidden. And that is the shirk which deals with intentions and with sincerity. And this is, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, this is an ocean which its shore cannot be seen. Meaning, this is a very vast area of shirk, big area of shirk. So many people, everyone is subject to it, even the companions. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were fearful from this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, الَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِيلَةٌ. This verse means the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they were doing good deeds, but yet their hearts were fearful whether those actions will be accepted or not. To the degree that it is narrated about Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, that he said, if I could guarantee that two rak'ahs from me other than the obligatory prayers would be accepted by Allah, I will guarantee paradise. They said, how is that? He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. And he says, وَأُعِدَّتِ الْجَنَّةِ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So if I guarantee that Allah accepts from me, then this equals that I am amongst muttaqeen. And if I am amongst muttaqeen, then this equals I am in paradise. See? MashaAllah, he knew Pythagoras theory and math. If this equals this, then this equals this. This is not bad. It helps to understand. This is Abdullah ibn Abbas. Because some people nowadays, when they know that you are an engineer, and yet you know some knowledge of Sharia, they make fun of you. They say, why are you talking about knowledge of Sharia? You are an engineer. You go and speak math. You don't come and speak. They say this, unfortunately. A Muslim, alhamdulillah, is not a priest where he assigns himself to something only and doesn't know anything else about the rest of the world. This is not Islam. This is priesthood. We had great scholars, alhamdulillah, who were doing certain things. Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani was a watch fixer. He used to make his earnings from fixing watches. Okay. This kind of shirk must be feared a lot. This inner shirk, shirk in the intentions, this should be feared a lot. The Muslim must be very much aware of it. And we will come to it in detail, inshallah. Now, we have four differences between great shirk and small shirk. The first is that the great shirk takes someone out of Islam completely, while the smaller shirk does not. The second point is that the greater shirk causes the person to be in hellfire forever, but the smaller shirk will not. The third point is that the greater shirk will cause canceling all the actions, while the smaller shirk does not. Some forms of small shirk, like show-off, will cause the cancellation of any action which they accompany. If your action is accompanied by show-off, then that action, that particular action is cancelled. And the fourth point, the fourth difference, is that the great shirk causes one's blood and wealth to be unsacred, and the small shirk does not. Then the author goes into the next deviation, which is not less dangerous than the shirk, which is naturally the kufr. And kufr linguistically means to cover. Actually, the word cover in English probably has come from the word kafar in Arabic. Probably it is the same thing. Because kufr in Arabic, the linguistic meaning is to cover something. Taghtiyah, to cover it. To put some seed under the ground, under the sand, and cover it with the sand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called those people who do this, call them al-kuffar. Huh? The verse which says, لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمْ الْكُفَّارِ. Huh? This is regarding the farmers. The farmers. Also, in the religious sense, the word kufr is opposite to faith, opposite to iman. And it could be with denial or without denial. يعني كفر is not necessarily to disbelieve in something or to deny it. This is a form of kufr, but it is not all kufr. Unfortunately, nowadays, some people has confused the issue of kufr with denial. And they made kufr specific to denial and specific to disbelief. And that is not the case. That is not the case. Even some of those who call themselves Salafis nowadays has defined kufr to mean denial. They define kufr to be denial. And therefore, there is no other form of kufr to them. And this is, if you say kufr is denial, then kufr is opposite to faith. Then what is opposite to denial? Tasdiq, affirmation. Then you have to say that iman is only tasdiq, which is the saying of the Jahmis, the saying of those who follow Jahm. Jahm says iman is knowledge, to know. That's all. Tasdiq, to know. Okay? So those people who say kufr means disbelief, then necessarily what is opposite to kufr, that is faith, is what is opposite to disbelief, which is belief. And this is not the case. So because faith is belief and beyond other actions of the heart, similarly kufr could be disbelief and other actions of the heart. Okay. Then the Sheikh says, there are two types of kufr, the greater kufr, which takes someone out of Islam, and the smaller kufr. And then the greater kufr is five types. Not one, not the denial, but four more others. The first is the denial. Kufr takdhib, to deny something, to say it is untrue, to disbelieve in it. This is the first. This is just the first. We have four more. This is the point. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in Quran that who is to be more unjust than the ones who deny what comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second form of great kufr is the kufr of pride, the false pride, which is the kufr of Iblis, the kufr of Fir'aun, the kufr of many nations. Most of the kufr is of this type, not of the first type. Most of the kufr the kufr of Iblis, the kufr of Fir'aun, the kufr of most of the people who are mentioned in the Quran. It's not the first type, which is denial. No, it is the second type. That is to believe in something that it is true, but not to accept it due to self-pride. Not because you don't believe it. You know it is true. When Allah ordered Shaitan to prostrate, who can say that Shaitan was not sure it is Allah who is ordering him or not? No one can say this. Therefore, it is not the kufr of disbelief. But Allah has said, إلا إبليس استكبر. He became bluffed with pride, false pride, full with false pride, and he did not accept to prostrate. Even though he knew that the one who is ordering him is his Lord, his Creator. But he did not accept it due to pride. So this is the second type of kufr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we told the angels to prostrate to Adam, so they did. Except Iblis. This does not mean that Iblis was an angel. He was with them at that time. He was accompanying them for some reason. Because in the other verse, Allah says, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ. Except Iblis, he was amongst the jinn. He is different. He is not an angel. But this time, he was with the angels, and Allah ordered the angels to prostrate to Adam. Iblis did not accept, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ. He refused due to pride. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And therefore, by this action, by being proud not to accept the order of Allah, and because of pride, he became a kafir. He was a kafir. The third form of great kufr is the doubts. Not total denial, but you have doubts. This is different than denial. You could have a belief in it, but you have some doubts. This is also a kufr by itself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf regarding the person who says that when I am turned to my Lord, I will find something better. And he said, before that he said, I don't think the hour is coming. وَمَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمَةً وَمَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمَةً. I don't think the hereafter is coming soon. Or something like this. The fourth type of great kufr, this is to turn away, i'rad, to turn away, not even due to pride, no, for any worldly reason, for any worldly gain, you commit kufr. For example, someone who is living amongst people who worship the graves and saints, and he wants to be friendly to them, so he does what they do. He goes around the grave. Or he shows himself that he's supplicating to the wali. He's like them. Even though he does not believe in it in his heart. But he is like them because he is resembling them in this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَن يَتَوَلَّهُم مِّنكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. And he says, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. He who resembles a group of people, he is like them. If he resembles them in kufr, then he is like them in kufr. If he resembles them in shirk, then he is like them in shirk. If he resembles them in a sin, then he will be a sinner like them. Not a kafir, of course. Fifth type of kufr is the kufr of nifaq, the kufr of hypocrisy. And of course, this will come later when the author speaks about hypocrisy. And the second type of kufr is the smaller kufr, which does not take someone out of Islam. Which are the sins? The sins which are called kufr, but they do not reach the level of great kufr. For example, the Prophet ﷺ says, cussing the Muslim is fusuq. While killing him is kufr. murdering him is kufr. This is a sin, but it's called kufr. So this is a small kufr. Why is it kufr? Because Allah called it kufr, or the Messenger called it kufr. Why is it not great kufr, which leads someone out of Islam? Because it's a sin. Murdering someone is a sin. It's not shirk. So this is the smaller kufr. The Prophet ﷺ said, do not turn after me kafirs. One of you beating the neck of the other. Killing the other. لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا. يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. And many other sins where the Prophet ﷺ called them kufr. Called the sin kufr. And in general, the author says, there are four differences between the great kufr and the small kufr. The first, that the great kufr takes someone out of Islam, causes all the actions to be cancelled, while the smaller kufr does not take you out of Islam and does not cause all the actions to be cancelled. But of course, it decreases your faith and Islam. And the second point is that the great kufr causes someone to stay in hellfire forever, while the small kufr does not cause the person to stay in hellfire forever. He might repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and might be forgiven and will not enter fire at all. And the third point is that great kufr causes one's blood and wealth to be unsacred, while the small kufr does not cause that. And the fourth is very important, and that is the great kufr obligates and necessitates hatred, pure hatred for the person who commits it. You have to hate the kafir. And here again, we point out to the difference between hating a kafir and doing injustice to him. They are both obligations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر يوادون من حد الله ورسوله. You would not find a group of people who believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, and at the same time, they have love for the kafirs, those who oppose to Allah. But then after that, Allah says, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم. Allah does not forbid you. This does not just mean Allah does not forbid you. It means Allah orders you. Allah does not forbid you from being just to those kafirs who do not cause you to be kicked out of your homes and fight you. Allah does not forbid you from being just to them. This means Allah orders you to be just to them. Because justice is a principle in Islam. It's not a favorable action. It's not just a favorable action. It is an obligation. Justice towards Allah by worshipping Him alone. And justice towards the Muslims. And justice towards all humans. Justice towards all creatures. Justice is a must. It's one of the principles of Islam. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ. Allah orders justice. It's a must. It's not something that you do it as a favor or something favorable. No, it's a must. And as I mentioned the hadith earlier, those who do harm to a kafir that has an oath with the Muslims will not even smell the smell of paradise, which shows it is a major sin. This means it's a major sin. And also the Prophet ﷺ mentioned about harming the kafir who has an oath with Muslims. And he said, I'm innocent of those who harm the such people. So this shows it's a great sin. So this distinction must be clear. Then the author speaks about hypocrisy, its definition and its forms. The Arabic meaning of nifaq, it is to be zigzaggy, to come out of one hole and enter another. Okay, like in a zigzag way, in a zigzag way. يعني not to be straightforward, right? Not to be straightforward. Believe something in the heart and show something else. Believe something in the heart and say something different. That's why lying is one of the branches of practical hypocrisy. Practical hypocrisy. Huh? So to show what is different than it's what's in your heart, this is nifaq. This is nifaq. And also it is two kinds. The nifaq i'tiqadi in belief. And this is great kufr, which takes you out of Islam. And it consists of 6 points. The first point is to deny what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has ordered you, or what he has informed you. To deny it. This is great hypocrisy, which will take you out of Islam. And within this, which can also be considered a second type, within it is to deny part of what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told you. You don't have to deny everything to be a denier, or to be a hypocrite, or to be a kafir. If you deny one sure thing, you are out of Islam. You are out of faith. You are into hypocrisy. That is, if you deny it in your heart, even if you show otherwise, you are still a hypocrite, a kafir. To deny one thing which you know the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has came with makes you out of Islam. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Ala inna sil'ata Allahi ghaliya. Ala inna sil'ata Allahi al-jannah." The product of Allah is expensive. The product of Allah is paradise. Something huge, something great. So you don't get it easily. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people think that they will be left alone to say by tongue, we believe, without being tested? So anyone who thinks this, he is a fool. Huh? Anyone who thinks that he will never be tested, actually he is thinking that he will be fooling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who is to think that but a disbeliever and but a fool? The third point of great hypocrisy, which takes someone out of Islam, is to hate what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has came with. You might not deny it, you might accept it to be the truth, but you hate it. You hate jihad. This is kufr. You hate fasting. This is kufr. But we have to distinguish between hatred and feeling painful. Huh? Hating jihad means that you believe in your heart that jihad has no good. Allah has ordered us to kill ourselves for no good reason. To believe in your heart that jihad is for no wisdom. To believe in your heart that jihad brings nothing but corruption. This is kufr. To believe in your heart that fasting has no good, it's harmful. This is kufr. This will take you out of Islam, even if you are fasting. What's the use? You are fasting by being hungry, actually, not fasting. And in your heart, you are cussing at Allah, or you are mistrusting Allah, thinking that He obligated fasting on you for nothing, for no good reason. Then you are not a Muslim, you are a kafir. Because you are hating part of the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the fourth point. Hating part of what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come with. The third was hating all the Sharia. Just like denial, two types. Denying all the Sharia and denying part of the Sharia. Hating all the Sharia and hating part of the Sharia. No difference. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Are you going to believe in some of the book and disbelieve in the other? You cannot. You have to believe in the whole book. Otherwise, you will not be a believer. The fifth aspect of great hypocrisy, which takes someone out of Islam and out of faith, is to be happy when the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is low, when the rule of Allah is not applied. You are happy and you think in your heart that this is the best for the Muslims. Then you are a hypocrite, you are not a Muslim. So to be happy when the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has become belittled by the people and has not been applied, the rule of Allah has not applied, to be happy with the situation and to believe that this is the best for us, this is great nifaq, will take you out of Islam. And also to be sad when the word of Islam is high and when the rules of Islam are uppermost and when Islam is applied, Sharia of Islam is applied, and you feel sad, you feel bad, you feel that this is not good for us, this is going to be an obstacle to progress, this is kufr. This will take you out of Islam. This is great nifaq. And the second form of hypocrisy is the practical hypocrisy, which does not take you out of Islam. It has four branches. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are four points. If they are in some person, then he will become a pure hypocrite. Meaning that those four qualities are of pure hypocrite's qualities. That is to lie and to break the oath and to be very unjust in your quarreling or discussion, to cuss at people for no reason, to say bad things, to accuse people, to use ghiba and namima and other things. This is all not from Islam. It is from hypocrisy. And to break an oath or to not to keep the trust if you are entrusted, then these are branches of practical hypocrisy. One should be very afraid if he has all those in him. Then he should question himself whether he is a hypocrite or not. And questioning yourself is not something which is bad. You have to question yourself. Even the companions radiallahu anhum questioned themselves regarding small hypocrisy. So these are aspects of small hypocrisy. And in general, there are four differences. The great hypocrisy takes someone out of Islam, while the smaller does not. The great hypocrisy is to be different in your heart than what shows on your limbs. And actually, the small hypocrisy is to be different in particular or certain actions, not in everything. And the third is to the great hypocrisy does not come from a believer. There cannot be in one's heart great hypocrisy or great kufr or great shirk and Islam and faith. They cannot be together. Great kufr cannot be with faith in your heart or Islam in your heart. Similarly, great hypocrisy cannot. But here you have to be very careful. Ahl Sunnah believe that there can be in your heart faith and small hypocrisy, faith and small kufr, faith and small shirk. This is special of Ahlus Sunnah. Khawarij and Mu'tazila and others, they don't believe this. They don't know this. They don't make a distinction between levels of religion, Islam and Iman. Everything is one. If you have any small hypocrisy in you, you are a kafir out of Islam, according to those people. If you have any hypocrisy in you, you are a kafir. That's why it's easy for them to call anyone a kafir. You see? If he decides that you have lied, then you are a kafir. If he decides that you have done such and such action, which is considered to be supporting the kafirs or aligning yourself with the kafirs, then you are a kafir. Okay? But this is not the way of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And then we have other concepts of deviation, like jahiliyyah, like fusq, like dhalal, like ridda. Jahiliyyah is a term which means ignorancy, actually. Ignorancy, from jahl, ignorance. Jahl is ignorance. Jahiliyyah. And it is two types. One is the absolute jahiliyyah. And this has been wiped out since sending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no such a jahiliyyah anymore. Therefore, to say that we are living in a total jahiliyyah now, this is wrong. Okay, like what Sayyid Qutb says in his books. Okay, there is no such description of total jahiliyyah now. After Islam, alhamdulillah, we have Muslims. We have Muslims. But there is a second kind of jahiliyyah, and that is a special jahiliyyah. Jahiliyyah in some of our actions, in some places, in some attitudes, in some sayings, in some actions, but not a total jahiliyyah. So this is an important distinction, because we find, unfortunately, people nowadays, because of their enthusiasm and things like that, and ignorance also, they say we are living in a total jahiliyyah, and they consider those people who are applying parts of Islam, they consider them not to be applying anything. Okay? And this is not true. The second conception, or the second conception, is fusq, fusuq. Fusuq is to come out of something in Arabic, fasaq, to come out of it. And religiously, it means to come out of obedience to Allah and His Messenger, not to obey Allah and His Messenger. This is the religious meaning. To do a major sin, this is fasiq. Someone who does a major sin and he does not repent on it, he insists on it, then he's a fasiq. He's not a kafir, he's a fasiq. And then dalal, which means misguidance. Misguidance. Dalal. And even if you differ from the truth, this also could be called dalal. But in this case, you might differ from the truth because of an ijtihad, like a scholar. So it is called dalal, but the person who has fallen into this mistake is not dal. So we have to make a distinction also, that the dalal, there are levels. One which is clearly dalal against Quran and Sunnah, and one that might be a difference, which could be against Quran and Sunnah and could not. Also, dalal is immerse something in something. This is called dalal. To put something into, to dip it inside, this is called dalal also. The fourth conception regarding those deviations is called ridda. To reject the faith. To reject the faith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا ترتدوا على أعقابكم. Do not turn away from the religion. Don't go back to misguidance. Don't go back to kufr. And this happens by doing anything which is a contradiction to Islam. Anything which is a contradiction to Islam that you do, this causes the ridda. If it is something clear and you do it, then you are murtad, kafir. If it is something that is vague, most of the people don't know, then before calling some person kafir, you have to prove it to him and show it to him and teach him. So this is regarding ridda. It could be by tongue, by saying something. It could be by action. It could be by belief. Not only by belief. It could be also by doubt, to doubt something. And if someone becomes a rejecter of faith, then he is asked to repent. This is called istitaba. Asked to repent. The ruler or someone who represents the ruler will ask him. Not everyone of us. We cannot go in the street and see someone doing something wrong and make istitaba for him, like the ignorance nowadays do. And this is chaos. This will lead to bloodshed and fitna and chaos. And the second thing is that if he does not accept to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his rejecting of the faith, he should be killed. Again, this is decided by the people who are in authority, the ruler and the scholars who follow the ruler. The Prophet ﷺ says, as narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, he who changes the religion, then kill him. This is narrated by Bukhari and Abu Dawood. And he should be prevented from dealing with his wealth if he rejects the faith until he repents. If he repents, his wealth will go back to him. Otherwise, it will be taken from him, all his wealth. And the fourth, no inheritance between him and his children and wife and all those who inherit from him. And if he dies or if he is killed, he should not be buried with the Muslims. He should not be preyed upon. These are the rulings regarding the ridda. And this, inshallah, gives a brief view of all the misconceptions that the author has started with. I think the reason why he started with the misconceptions is to show the importance of learning tawheed. Yani, if someone knows what is shirk and how easy to fall into it, and the various ways that one can fall into shirk, and knows also kufr, and how dangerous it is, and what is the outcome, and how easy it is to fall, and how various are the gates to it, and similarly nifaq, hypocrisy, then if he wants to be saved from the everlasting wrath and punishment, he should rush to learn what leads to those things, because these are the worst things which one can fall into. I think that's why the author has started with those things, to give the person the enthusiasm to learn the details. If this is shirk and kufr and nifaq, I want to know exactly in detail what are the beliefs, what are the actions, what are the sayings which will cause this. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد.